But first, how some American companies are requiring workers to sign contracts that limit career mobility. While they are not well known, companies can use these contracts to prevent an employee from working for a competitor. Lawmakers are worried that it's gone too far and are trying to weaken or even outright ban them. In fact, the Massachusetts State Senate today debated its own bill to limit them. But many say these agreements are not likely to go away. Special correspondent Duarte Geraldino has the story for our series, Making Sense, which airs on Thursdays.
In a small industrial park in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, the Allure Lampshade Factory.
We take pride in the fact that everything's made in America. The metal, the frame, the lining, the trimming. And our stickers are made in the USA, too.
Well, everything's made in the USA.
Exactly.
Mark Van Wettering has been making lampshades since he was a teenager. Opened his own business in 2007, just before the start of the Great Recession.
I had to do a bankruptcy, a Chapter 13, to get myself in order and lost my home. But I held on to this business, and I bet everything on myself and on the company that we would succeed.
To boost his odds, he thought about having his employees sign a non-compete contract, which would have prevented them from quitting to go to work at any one of his three local rivals.
I saw a lawyer. I had it drawn up. I couldn't find it in me to bring it to the table and have my employees sign it. If someone feels that they have a better opportunity somewhere else, I'm all for it.
But nearly 40% of all American workers have, at some point, signed a non-compete contract, including one out of every six workers earning less than $40,000 a year. Some of them, much less, like Genoveva Ochoa, a Central American immigrant who speaks practically no English.
El papel de no compete.
And yet knows the phrase non-compete. Ochoa came to the U.S. 5 years ago and almost immediately went to work at Allure.
I learned everything here.
But 2 years ago, she says her husband convinced her to join him at nearby Canterbury Lampshades, which offered her 50 cents more an hour, but also made her sign a non-compete contract.
They called me into the office and said, here are the papers you need to sign, and if you don't sign, you don't get the job.
She signed, but she says Canterbury failed to give her full-time hours, so she quit and returned to Allure. Canterbury has since sued both Ochoa and Van Wettering for violating the non-compete agreement.
This is so unfair. Forcing people to sign these papers, it's like cutting off our hands because we can't work anywhere else.
Ochoa offered to resign from Allure. Van Wettering wouldn't hear of it. Instead, he filed a countersuit. For the record, Canterbury declined our interview request.
First of all, we hired her originally. We taught her the skills that she has. I can't believe there'd be a judge somewhere in the state of Florida who would agree with my competitor that a person making $9 or less.
$9 or less?
Yeah. Assembling lampshades is now subject to a non-compete clause.
Believe it, says his lawyer, Jonathan Pollard.
This degree of absurdity is unique to Florida.
If there's a judge anywhere who might enforce Canterbury's contract, says Pollard, that judge is probably in Florida, one of the more pro-business states.
Non-compete law is a creature of state law. On one end of the spectrum, you have California, where employee non-compete agreements are unenforceable. And on another end of the spectrum, you have Florida, where they're highly enforceable.
Of course, even in Florida, most non-compete contracts are reserved for higher-level employees who have access to trade secrets.
Recipes for cookies, profit margins, customer lists.
And as attorney Russell Beck, who writes an influential blog, points out,
billions of dollars of trade secrets are stolen on an annual basis, and there needs to be some mechanism for protecting them.
Several studies suggest theft of trade secrets robs the U.S. economy of some $300 to $500 billion a year. Headlines warn of larcenous employees looking to lift a lot more than paperclips. No wonder non-compete contracts have proliferated, popping up in some surprising sectors of American life.
The way they made it very clear to us from the beginning is that we were volunteer providers. We're not employees of the company.
And yet, in the paperwork that you signed, you had to sign a non-compete?
We did.
Yes. Can you get the drinks, honey?
Omar and Damaris Saeed are foster parents licensed by Florida to care for special needs children.
They have autism, bipolar, intellectual disability.
Some of them have all three. A lot of times the children that have these behaviors are in institutions. And the state wants to step them down into group homes, but we need people that are willing to open up and do this type of service.
In 2012, the Saeed signed a detailed contract with a private company called LifeShare to take David and Cyrus into their home. LifeShare would train and supervise the Saeeds and also give them a portion of what the state paid for the boys' care. The Saeeds agreed to provide a long list of services.
Robert, sir, this isn't babysitting. This is a therapeutic setting. We're constantly taking data, annotating behaviors, looking at trends, graphing that information. We have therapists coming in and out. We have doctor's appointments.
Cyrus, now 17, had been in an institution.
Here is a lot more better. They care about you. They don't let other people hurt you. A lot of the places, they didn't do that.
Did they hurt you?
Yes, sometimes. They let the boys hurt me.
What did they do?
Punch me, kick me. One of them tries to break my arm.
Okay, and so whoever wins, what do we say?
Good game.
Good game, good job.
This level of foster care can be physically and emotionally challenging.
Yeah, I've gotten pushed in the face, he's gotten bitten, he's got nose broken.
You know, we don't take it personal. This is a challenge that they were born with. Mm-hmm. It's our job to help them manage it.
But according to the contract, the response to violent outbursts was to dial 911, then a LifeShare hotline, and wait for a callback. LifeShare wouldn't comment, but the Saeed say the company often told them to lock themselves in their bedroom.
What happens if he gets into glass or into some of the kitchenware or, you know, rips the TV from the wall and injures themselves?
So we were getting hurt. The boys were getting hurt. And we would call the cops, and then the cops would say, if you don't know how to control them, then these boys do not have any business being here in your home.
Fearing they would lose Cyrus and David, the Saeeds decided to terminate the contract with LifeShare and deal directly with the state, which was urging a more hands-on approach. They say LifeShare immediately invoked the non-compete clause, withholding their monthly stipend and demanding they either give up the boys or pay $20,000 to keep them.
I love it. Every single one of them, and we feel that these kids do not deserve to have a price tag.
We just wanted to walk away and continue doing the work that we feel that we've been called to do. LifeShare would not have that.
Jonathan Pollard represents the Saeeds in what has now turned into a complex litigation.
LifeShare is saying we have a non-compete agreement. Those children are basically our property.
How is that possible?
There's nothing to stop anyone from putting together a non-compete agreement for anything.
In part, that's why a national movement against non-competes is picking up steam. The White House and U.S. Treasury are investigating as 9 states look to restrict their use and 5 want to ban them altogether.
Non-compete contracts are increasingly unenforceable, but employers keep asking workers to sign these contracts. For example, in California, workers sign non-compete contracts at a higher rate than most Americans, and yet, in that state, these contracts carry almost no legal weight.
So what, then, is their purpose?
Those agreements are just restricting competition and employee mobility, which means you can pay your folks less money and have a better bottom line at the end of the day. That's what it's about, it's greed.
There are definitely companies that use these agreements as a retention tool. That's not what they're designed for, and companies shouldn't be doing that.
But to be clear, you believe that there is a place in the future of the American workforce for these non-competes?
Absolutely. They just can't be abused.
That's the struggle for policymakers. Non-competes can promote innovation and entrepreneurship, but they also have the potential to act like economic nooses around the necks of workers and even competing businesses.
I want to compete, but I want to compete on a fair playing field.
In Fort Lauderdale, Duarte Geraldino for PBS NewsHour.